you as a doctor give hope and health to many each day, there are many more to give hope and health to. And with Fujifilm, we are doing that together.
So now what we are going to do is, I'll be giving you about 10 seconds. There'll be a particular format on which you'll have to look at the radiograph and give me the answer, right? So you don't have to type the answers. Please don't bother about it. Just be true to yourself. And once, just keep in your mind what you think is the diagnosis, and then I'll show you the diagnosis. This is a trial run. So here you can see this is an AP and lateral radiograph of the knee. And this is the particular format you're going to look at. So medial femoro-tibial compartment looks normal. Lateral, you can see that there is some osseous fragment. So there is a fracture. The fracture is extending up to the articular surface. There is some articular surface depression. Okay, patellofemoral compartment looks normal. Central, I don't see any avulsion fractures of the intercondylar remnants. Displaced, yes, this does look out of place. So there is some mild displacement of the fracture fragment. Effusion, yes, there is a small effusion that is present. So this is the particular format. When you look at every X-ray in this format, you will not miss on any of the findings. And this particular format is predominantly, for now, we are going to only report fractures and injuries. Arthritis we'll be discussing later. So just concentrate on fractures and injuries. If you see joint space narrowing, for now, just ignore it. Okay. So this was a very obvious finding. This was a lateral femoral condyle fracture and also called as the Hofer's fracture. Okay, so I give you 10 seconds. Just have a look at it. Make up a diagnosis in your mind. Okay. Medial compartment looks normal. Lateral, yes, you see a fracture. You see that there is a line over here, and this is a lateral tibial plateau fracture. Now, this lateral tibial plateau fracture has a gap also. It is reaching up to the articular surface. This is my articular surface gap. Also, if you see, this is how your tibial plateau should have been. So there is some articular surface depression or step off as well. You cannot see a patellofemoral compartment on the AP view, so that's not applicable. Central, normal, displaced, no, but depressed, yes. So it is a depressed lateral tibial plateau fracture with an articular surface gap. Effusion, you cannot comment on the AP view. So again, this was an obvious finding. This was a lateral tibial plateau fracture, which is also called as a Schatzker fracture. This is another example of a very obvious Schatzker fracture, and which is in fact Schatzker type 5, where even there is a dissociation between the tibial metaphysis and the tibial diaphysis. Whereas here, if you'll see, this is a very subtle Schatzker fracture. So if you are just, you know, if you look at this X-ray hurriedly, I bet on it that you will miss the fracture. But when you have a particular format of how to look at the X-ray, you will pick up that this is the fracture. It is not so well seen on the lateral radiograph, but on the AP radiograph, you can appreciate that there is a lateral tibial plateau fracture, not much of an articular surface step off or gap. Next case, you have 10 seconds. Okay. So again, grossly, I don't see anything, no big fractures, no joint space narrowing, nothing. Medially, this side, really nothing. Laterally, you can see this small osseous flake over here. This could be a fracture or this can be a calcification in the left knee joint, okay, which is where the medial collateral ligament goes and attaches. So I told you this is one of the review areas. Again, lateral normal, patellofemoral normal. Displaced, no, this fragment is not displaced. Effusion, you cannot comment on an AP view. So this is your medial collateral ligament. And here you will see that this fracture fragment is in place of the medial collateral ligament. So this is not so obvious finding. You'll have to actually look for it. And this is a Pellegrini striata lesion. Pellegrini striata lesion is nothing. It can be a avulsion fracture from the medial femoral condyle, or in chronic MCL injuries, calcification can develop towards the femoral attachment and it can give this appearance. Next is again an AP and a lateral radiograph. 10 seconds. Get the diagnosis in your mind. Follow the format. Medial looks okay. Lateral looks okay. Patellofemoral, I don't see anything. Now, next is central. And you can see that there is a fracture over here. Okay, so you can see that now if you closely see, because you've seen the fracture over here, Lateral, if you've not seen this lateral, you may actually miss this fracture because of the overlap. But you'll see this is your fracture fragment, right? And this fracture fragment has surely displaced superiorly. So there is some mild superior displacement of the fracture fragment. Effusion, yes, you have a small effusion over here. So this, if you'll see, fracture fragment is along the tibial attachment of anterior cruciate ligament. So that is the femoral attachment. This is your tibial attachment. And this tibial attachment fibers has avulsed off a bone piece in this patient. And so if you correlate with the MR, that's your ACL and that is the avulsed bone piece. Similarly, here is the avulsed bone piece and you can see that there is a lot of marrow edema. So this is not an obvious finding. You'll have to actually look for it. And this is an anterior tibial intercondylar eminence fracture, which is nothing but an anterior tibial avulsion fracture. Again, in this patient, you cannot see anything on the AP view, but when you see on the lateral view, you can clearly appreciate that this is your fracture fragment and it is slightly shifted superiorly. So this is another patient with an ACL avulsion fracture. Okay, again, the same format, 10 seconds. All right. So same thing, medial normal, lateral normal, patellofemoral normal. What is important is central. Now, again, here you don't see anything, but in this particular case, you can see that there is a fracture over here. It's a very subtle fracture. It's not displaced. So unless you actually look at this region, you're going to miss this fracture. Displaced? No, there is no displacement of the osseous fragment. And yes, there is an effusion over here. So please make sure that you follow this format so that you don't miss any of the fractures. Now, this particular osseous fragment is along the attachment of the posterior cruciate ligament fibers. So this is your femoral attachment and this is how the PCL comes and attaches to the tibia posteriorly. And this is where it has avulsed off a bone from the tibial plateau or the intercondylar eminence. And this is the MRI image of the patient where you can see that the PCL is good, but it has avulsed off a bone from the underlying tibia. So this is a PCL tibial attachment avulsion fracture. Another thing, just a lateral view. Again, if I would just see this x-ray in a hurry without using my review areas, I'm going to miss the fracture. But if I start looking at the review areas, this is your fracture. So there is actually a lot of overlap from other bones. So unless you look for it, you're going to miss it. The key important thing to mention in this report is that there is a superior displacement of the osseous fragment. Also on the MR, you can see that this osseous fragment is displaced superiorly by almost 9 millimeters. And why this is important, be it an ACL or a PCL avulsion fractures, if the displacement is more than 5 millimeters, they usually go and fix back the bone piece. And that needs to be done immediately or on an urgent basis. You cannot do it after months later, because if the bone piece is not fixed back immediately, the bone will undergo osseous remodeling. And once it undergoes osseous remodeling, this bone will not fix back into the defect in the bone. So this is like a jigsaw puzzle and it won't fix back in the jigsaw puzzle. So therefore, it is very important that you pick up these avulsion fractures. And if they are superiorly displaced, you need to mention that so that the orthopod knows what he needs to do next for the patient. Another case, 10 seconds. Okay, for all of you who has picked up this fracture, pat yourself, pat your back, because you've really done a very good job, because this is actually a very subtle finding. So grossly, I don't see anything. Medial compartment looks okay. Lateral compartment, actually here there's nothing. But if you closely observe, there is a small osseous plate which is there in this region. Okay, so there is a small fracture from the anterolateral tibial plateau, which I have already told you is a review area. So this, and in fact, on a lateral view, you will never see this fracture because of the overlap. Lest everything is normal, except that yes, it is mildly displaced. Effusion, you have an effusion over here. So this is actually along the attachment of the anterolateral ligament. And this is your anterolateral, it's a very thin ligament. So this is a normal MR image of the ligament. If you'll see, this is your anterolateral ligament. Okay, this. This is where it goes and attaches to the tibia, and this is its femoral attachment. So it's a very thin, slender ligament, and often with ACL injuries, anterolateral ligament can avulse off a bone from the anterolateral tibial plateau. And this is nothing but a Segonne's fracture. Here you can see that this ligament also doesn't look that healthy. It's injured, and you can see that it has avulsed off a bone from here. Now, why is this important? Segonne's fracture is one of those 100% signs. So if a Segonne fracture is present, there are 100% chances that patient has an ACL tear. So on a radiograph, if you pick up a Segonne fracture, then it's actually a eureka moment for you, because now you can actually call your orthopod and say that, boss, there is a Segonne fracture. There are chances that he has an ACL injury, underlying ACL injury. And your orthopod will be completely impressed with you. He will say, yes, my Lachman test is also positive. I'll send the patient for an MRI to confirm if there is any other findings in the scan. So this is how your report will start to make a difference and you will start to gain recognition. Another thing which is important is, if you get an MRI to report, often these fractures are so small, okay, that always remember, whenever there is an ACL injury on an MRI, look at the anterolateral tibial plateau to pick up a fracture. But often, again, in a hurry, you may forget to see this review area on the MRI. And during that time, the X-ray will be your savior. So even if you miss the Segonne's fracture on the MRI, because it's very small, if you look at the X-ray, you will get your answer that yes, he has a Segonne fracture. Now, why it is important? ACL injury is there. We know that from the MRI now. So why do we need to know if that there is a Segonne fracture? Because if there is a Segonne fracture, it needs to be repaired. Otherwise, the graft of the ACL can fail. So if the Segonne fracture is not addressed to, the patient can land up into an ACL graft failure and the patient will require a resurgery. And when that happens, remember that you are going to go down in the eyes of the orthopods. Second important thing is, whether you have seen the X-ray or not, 95% of the times your orthopod is going to see the X-ray and he is going to pick up this fracture. So please don't miss this fracture, be it on an X-ray, and please don't miss this fracture even if you are on reporting an MRI. So even if you're reporting an MRI, make sure to look at the X-ray to find such subtle fractures. So this is another patient where you can see that there is a Segonne fracture. This is another patient. So this Segonne fracture is displaced, whereas this is an essentially non-displaced Segonne fracture. So again, it's a subtle finding, but if you report it on an X-ray, it's an indirect indicator of ACL injury. Okay, another X-ray, 10 seconds, go. Okay, this is also a very subtle finding, just like a Segonne's fracture. And on the lateral compartment, the femorotibial is okay. But here you can see that there is a small osseous bone which has been chipped off from the fibular styloid or the fibular head. Okay, and the rest, everything is normal. It's essentially non-displaced. And obviously, you cannot comment on the effusion on an APV. So what is this fracture? Now, here, something called as the posterolateral corner goes and attaches to the fibular head, which is comprising of multiple structures, the important ones being popliteal fibular ligament, arcuate ligament, and your biceps femoris tendon and lateral collateral ligament. So whenever there is an ACL injury, it is often associated with posterolateral corner injury. And so whenever you see this fracture, again, it is an indirect indicator of a cruciate ligament injury. Posterolateral corner injury can happen with both ACL and PCL injuries. So, but if there is this fracture, you know that patient has some cruciate ligament is injured, either of the two. And why it is important, again, when the patient has an ACL tear, the patient goes for ACL graft reconstruction. If this thing is not identified, okay, on the X-ray and on the MR. Now, MRI, if you see, this is the MRI of the patient and the fracture is so small. You will surely miss this fracture on an MRI. I myself didn't pick up the fracture on the MRI, but before dispatching the report, I did see the X-ray. I saw this fracture and I reported on an MRI. So if you miss this fracture, again, if this situation is not addressed in the patient will result into ACL graft failure and a second surgery will be needed. So it is very important to pick up posterolateral corner injuries, just like it is important to pick up Segonne fractures. So it's an arcuate fracture or a posterolateral corner fracture. And again, it is an indirect indicator of cruciate ligament injury. Next is, I have given you a history that the patient has a history of twisting injury. And this is a very subtle finding. Only those who are aware of such a finding will be able to guess this. Okay, so I have given you two knees for comparison. Now, medially, just remember, on a lateral radiograph, the bone that is posterior and inferior is the medial condyle. Okay, the bone which is superior is your lateral condyle. So, medially, there is nothing much, but laterally, I've already told you, this particular area is your sulcus terminalis. Okay. And here you can see that there is a depression in the sulcus terminalis. Okay. So this depression is nothing but it is again an indirect indicator of anterior cruciate ligament injury. Rest, everything is normal. Okay. Now, why is the sulcus terminalis or why does this happen in the first place? So whenever there is a twisting injury, the tibia and there is a resultant ACL tear, the tibia will translate anteriorly. The posterolateral tibia impacts against the anterolateral femur in the region of the sulcus terminalis. And that as a result of which you get this depression. So here on the MRI also, you can appreciate that there is a depression and there is a lot of marrow edema in this region. So on the MRI, it doesn't matter because you can see the ACL, whether there is sulcus terminalis depression or not, it has no prognostic value. But if you get an X-ray for reporting and you see this finding, again, you can put in the report that there is sulcus terminalis depression and clinical correlation for anterior cruciate ligament insufficiency is requested. So at least the orthopod knows that this patient could be having an anterior ligament laxity. Sulcus terminalis depression can be in acute injury or it can be in a chronic injury. So you don't know whether the ACL injury is acute or chronic. If you have a clinical history, that's great. If you don't, then you don't know whether it's an acute or chronic. But you surely know that some point in time, this patient did have an ACL injury. So that's how you can correlate your X-ray findings to report soft tissue injuries, which are not seen on the X-rays. So again, it's a subtle finding and it's an indirect indicator of ACL injury. Okay, this is a very subtle finding, sudden onset of medial pain, no trauma. Okay, a word of caution before we go ahead, don't over-report these X-rays, okay? Unless you have a classical history and the finding is really obvious, then you put it on paper, otherwise do not over-report this X-ray. So medial femoro-tibial compartment, what this patient has is this line of sclerosis. Again, I told you that this is your review area. And you can see this line of sclerosis over here. It's very subtle. If you are not confident, it's okay. You may not report it. If you're confident about it, you have a history that the patient has pain in the medial tibial condyle region, you can raise a suspicion. Okay? The rest, everything is normal. And what this is a proximal medial tibial stress fracture. And this was the MRI of the patient where you can see that this was the hypointense signal with a lot of marrow edema. So if you're not confident, you can actually not put it in the report. You can just call up the orthopod and tell him that this is what I feel. It may or may not be, but an MRI would be a good option to confirm if the patient is having a stress fracture or not. Next case, 10 seconds. This is a very important case with two findings. I've given you a hint. There are two findings. And arthritis is not one of the findings. Okay. So medially, you can see that there is a irregularity, right? And there is a medial femoral cortical irregularity. Lateral looks normal. Patellofemoral looks normal. Central looks normal. So what is the second finding? So now the second finding is this. You can see this small osseous bone, this osseous chip. So this could be a displaced osseous fragment. Okay, there is some amount of effusion. So medial femoral cortical irregularity with a displaced osseous fragment. This is a case of osteochondritis dissecans with a displaced osteochondral fragment in the suprapatellar region. Okay, so this was what it was. So please, for just remember that you can have very subtle, slender osseous fragments and don't miss them on the x-rays. And this was the MR of the patient, where you can see that there was this irregularity. There is small amount of osteochondral fragment which is seen in this region, but if you see, this particular osseous fragment is missing. So there is a small fragment in C2, but the other fragment is missing. And when you look at the MR, here you can see this is your osseous fragment, which is correlating with this particular X-ray. So this was the osteochondral fragment, which was displaced in the suprapatellar region, which could have been easily picked up on the X-ray as well. So these are some more examples of osteochondritis desiccans. Sometimes it can be where you can see the osteochondral fragment, which looks pretty much stable, but again, you cannot be 100% sure if it is stable or not. That is more of an MRI thing. Here, you can be 100% sure that this is an unstable fragment because you can see that there is a fracture and it is actually detached off from the parent bone. Again, here, you can see that there is a gap, a bigger radiolucent gap. So, this was also an unstable osteochondritis desiccans. None of these, to the extent that you can visualize, have a displaced osseous fragment. Next case, very obvious finding. Sorry, I don't have the AP view of this patient. Okay, so medial normal, lateral normal, patella, there is a fracture. This was a very obvious thing. The important thing is the fracture was not displaced. This is something that you really need to mention. Effusion, yes, there is effusion present. So it's an obvious finding, patella fracture. You need to differentiate it from the normal variant bipartite patella. So here also, if you will see, there is a radiolucent line. This is a skyline view, and you can see a radiolucent line, and it looks like a fracture. Then what is bipartite patella? Now, bipartite patella usually happens at the superolateral corner. So this is your fibula. So that's the superolateral corner. That's the one thing. Second thing, the radiolucent line is very wide. So if you go back and see, this fracture line is very ragged and a thin radiolucent line. Okay. Whereas this is a smooth radiolucent line and it is pretty wide. So that is a second way of how to differentiate a bipartite patella from a patella fracture. Third thing is the osseous fragment is very round. So it will have smooth edges. It will not have ragged edges. So that's how you differentiate between the normal variant and the actual patella fracture. And this was the MR in the patient where you can see that this is a very round bone at the superolateral aspect of patella. This was bipartite patella. Okay, so next case, 10 seconds. This is also not a very obvious finding. Okay, first thing, what you can see is that this is the immature skeleton, right? So you can see the physis and they're very well seen. So let's take the compartment approach. Medial is normal, lateral is normal. Patellofemoral, you can see this slender fracture over here. Right? So there is a small fracture at the inferior pole of patella. Rest everything is normal. There is no displaced osseous fragment. This fragment is also not displaced. Okay, and you don't see much of an effusion, at least on this radiograph. So it's a patellar sleeve avulsion fracture. Now, what is a patellar sleeve avulsion fracture? It is, in first of all, you need to understand that in an immature skeleton or in children who have a growing skeleton, the bones are relatively weaker than the ligaments and the tendons. Okay, so in them, the ligaments and tendons are stronger. The bones are still in the phase of ossification, so they are not as strong. As a result, you get avulsion fractures more commonly in children as compared to the adults. So all of this ACL avulsion, PCL avulsion, they can happen in adults, but they are very much common in children. Similarly, this periosteal sleeve avulsion usually happens in children where it is nothing but it is a avulsion of the periosteum, and along with that, it avulses off the articular cartilage from the inferior pole of patella at the patellar tendon attachment. Similar thing can also happen superiorly at the quadriceps tendon attachment. So this is nothing but a patellar sleeve avulsion fracture. And what is important is sometimes it is only the cartilage that has been avulsed off. The osseous fragment is not avulsed off. And in such cases, you will not be able to pick up this particular injury on a radiograph. And that's when ultrasound will be really helpful to identify the chondral fragment. Secondly, like this, usually these fractures are displaced and they require open reduction and internal fixation. You need to fix this back. Okay. But in fractures like this, which is not displaced, the patient can actually undergo a dynamic ultrasound where you can just see whether this fracture fragment is moving or not with flexion and extension. So if the fracture fragment is moving, the orthopod may consider a surgical intervention. If the fracture fragment is not moving, he may think to conserve the patient. Again, it's not a hard and fast rule, but it's just that it gives further information to the orthopod to take a decision. Next, again, this is a very subtle finding, but with a very big diagnosis. Okay. So, grossly, don't see anything. Medial is normal, lateral is normal, central is normal. Patellofemoral, what you see is that the bones are okay, but there is another extra bone lying over here, right? So, you can see this osseous piece which is sitting over here. Rest everything okay. Obviously, this is a displaced osseous fragment. You do not have any extra piece of bone lying in the Hofer's fat pad region. So it's a displaced osseous fragment and there is an effusion associated with it. A young patient, displaced osseous fragment, you can think of two things. One is osteochondritis desiccans. So when you see this fragment, go back, you see that the medial femur is actually looking very good. The second thing could be a patellar instability. Again, with this X-ray, you cannot be 100% sure whether it is OCD or it's a patellar instability, but likely chances that it's patellar instability because the medial femur looks very good. Okay, so you can just call up the orthopod and say that I'm seeing an osseous fragment displaced in the joint. Are you suspecting any patellar instability in the patient? And the orthopod will give you the answer that yes, this patient had a recent patellar dislocation, or on clinical examination, I feel that there is a patellar instability. If you cannot reach out to the orthopod, call up the patient, ask for the history. The patient may give you a history that I had a trauma and I just felt that my kneecap dislocated and came back. So all of this will help you to come to a diagnosis. Okay, so once you get this history of patellar dislocation, you have your answer that this was nothing but a patellar dislocation with a displaced osteochondral fragment. So this was the MRI picture where this was your osteochondral fragment. You can see this is your osteochondral fragment. The patient had a large lipohematrosis as well. And on the eggshell image, if you see from the patella, the osteochondral fragment is missing. And this was your osteochondral fragment lying in the joint recess. So this is how you can just add up 1+1 and come to a relevant diagnosis even on an X-ray. You do not always need, obviously the patient will require an MR imaging, but you are directing the orthopod in the right direction by suggesting him that this could be the diagnosis. Okay, next, just 10 seconds and have a look at the X-ray. It's an obvious finding if you know the pathology. Okay. So the finding is pretty obvious. You can see that there is an irregularity of the tibial tuberosity. And if you see that even the soft tissue appearance of the patella, so this looks thickened. The patellar tendon looks thickened, right? So we just follow the protocol and we find that the patellofemoral compartment, there is an abnormality. There is no displaced osseous fragment. There is not much of an effusion as well. So this is nothing but a Osgood-Schlatter disease. If you know this, you will not miss it. Okay, this was the MRI appearance of the Osgood-Schlatter disease where you can see that the patella also has signal within it. There is an additional ossification or a calcification adjacent to the tibial tuberosity. The tibial tuberosity is very much irregular and there is edema within it. So all of this just adds together to Osgood-Schlatter disease. So we've discussed of all the different kinds of pathologies that you may get on a X-ray radiograph as far as fracture and internal derangement is concerned. And we come back to the same X-ray. Okay. And now I want all of you to please answer the question again. Now, what do you think are the soft tissue structures which are injured? Okay, so most of you are getting one thing right, and that is the ACL. So yes, ACL everybody has picked up, which is probably secondary to sulcus terminalis depression. But the other thing was this. This is your small Segonz fracture. So even if I would not have given a lateral radiograph, still with this particular finding, you can say that the patient has an ACL injury or had an ACL injury in the past. So this was the answer, right? So at least I hope you guys now have a format in your mind how to go through these injuries before and how to report them.